me. So I'm Ashish Mittal, as Ishara just spoke. I'm a principal architect working in the open source division with Aditi Technologies. And today I'm going to talk about our experience of using WSO2 for building connected API ecosystems. Right, so before we start, let me just introduce Aditi Technologies. We are a technology services company with very strong focus on systems of engagement. Right? We help our customers transform their engagement with their end consumers, leveraging the convergence of design, device, analytics, and cloud. Right? How we do it? Connected devices, we help you deliver omnichannel experiences to your customers. We have a very strong partnership with Google, where we are the Open Handset Alliance. We are members of the Open Automotive Alliance, which is committed to bringing Android on the car. We are one of the very few companies who can certify a Google Android device. Right? Connected user experience, we have our in-house design team, which can help you deliver connected experience to your customers across all these devices. On the connected data aspect, we have our customers like Jaguar Land Rover, where we have teamed up with them to build a connected experience inside your car. So when you're driving a car, based on very few moves, the car recognizes who you are and delivers you personal experience, be it the temperature control or be it, you know, the music that you like. On the connected platforms, we are a cloud-first company, a cloud-first approach. We are the Microsoft partners for Azure, and we have partnerships with AWS as well. Right, and we do this at a global scale, around 40 offices spread across 23 countries with a workforce of around 7,500 people working on analytics, cloud, design, device, so on. Right, so let's jump onto the topic. Right? How we helped build connected ecosystem for one of our customer using WSO2. Right? So let's look at it, what the ask was. The ask was to expose business features as API. Right? Now, why would you want to do it? Why would you want to expose your business features as API? Right? Build a platform that helps you connect to massive communities of developers, end users, your partners, who can then take your features and offerings and incorporate them into innovative products and solutions, which can then be offered across devices, across different platforms, right? So let's recap. You have a business features, a platform which exposes your business features as APIs, which lets you connect to your partners who incorporate your features in their platform. And then when they do, your cash register rings. So you have increased revenue opportunities, you have increased customer outreach, innovative and integrated engagement with your customer. Right, so what does that involve? So if you have to do something like this, what does that involve? Obviously, you have to have APIs, right? What would be the characteristics of those APIs? First and foremost, they have to be discoverable, right? So somebody discovered a pretty round thing, he called it a wheel, but it was unless someone else took it, integrated with an axle, when it became one of the greatest inventions. So your APIs have to be discoverable by someone. Right? The next thing is your APIs have to be intelligent and contextual, because you have to provide personalized experience to your customer. So when someone calls your API, it has to return intelligent response based on his presence, based on his location, based on what he has done previously. Right? It has to talk to various devices, various protocols and formats. Right? Your APIs should be adaptable, because you are exposing your APIs to your partners. They should be able to build innovative solutions using it. Right? It should not restrict them. Instead, it should empower them to build innovative solutions. Right? And all this has to be done at scale, with high availability, with stringent performance SLAs. Right? Because if you are catering to not only your customers, but customers of your partners, they are going to be very unforgiving. Right? You have to take care of the spikes in scale, of being highly available across the global landscape and with high performance. right? These APIs have to be secure, and they have to be governed, and also have multi-tenancy built in, because now you're storing data for your partners, which could then be, you know, it should be separated if the partners want it, not overlap with each other. So that's why you need multi-tenancy. Right? So what are the solution components for such a thing? The first thing was, obviously, when you have APIs, you need an API manager. We coupled that API manager with an ESB, and what that gave us was capability to publish APIs, to subscribe APIs, to even have workflows on a sandbox environment. So when a developer comes and signs up for your API, you have a workflow to say, you are eligible to use only the sandbox environment, and then maybe promote him to a production environment. So you can have different API keys doing that. Right. Next, how do you solve the problem of scale? So all of the entire application stack is deployed on AWS with a multi-region, multi-zone hosting, which gives you a very high availability. So even if one data center gets impacted for some region, you have another, the other set of application servers running in the another region. Right? Next is managing security. Because you have so many people trying to talk to your APIs in various different ways, you need identity as a shared service, which can then simplify your needs or serve their purpose for different protocols, different authentications, and different authorization needs. Right? Why did we choose WSO2? So we evaluated a lot of leading competing vendors, and the following criteria were used: capability versus requirement. So the capability required versus the requirement that the product has. We just talked about it in the last slide. The various formats and protocols, right? Because you have to be adaptable, support various use cases. You need to have a platform which can support different protocols, different formats. Design and runtime governance. I mean, governance is one of the features which is often an afterthought, but if you need a sustained scale, you need to think about both design time governance as well as runtime governance. Right? You needed a cohesive platform suite, which, because if you're using multiple products, developers who work on one side of the application need to find the other things intuitive. Right? So when you move across different products of WSO2, because you have a single platform, it's very easy for developers to start using something else. Familiarity to Java J2E and resource availability, because again, it's built on Apache Axis, it's very easy, even if you have not used WSO2 earlier, for someone to start using it. We wanted someone with the inherent cloud vision and a good support and documentation. Right. So let's quickly look at the logical architecture that we had for this. So the bottom layer, or the entire business logic, is built using reusable, lean business services called the microservices. Right? So each of your services, as you can see, are individually deployed, are individually hosted on cloud, and they have their own data access layer. Right? What this provides me is heterogeneous services, which can each be developed in isolation in their own stack. It gives me resilience, because even if one service goes down, I have, my entire stack does not get impacted. Each of them are deployed separately. Right? It gives me scale, because tomorrow, let's say if you want to scale just one part of your functionality, maybe just the subscriptions, just the vouchers, you take just that instance and host it on other servers. Right? And obviously, this also caters to your replaceability, where you want to replace your service contract and things like those. Right? They are all connected to the NoSQL database. We are using Cassandra from DataStax. The common layer, or the boilerplate code, now you want your developers to focus on your business logic. You don't want them to be spending time on common functionalities like message brokering, the transformations, the authorization checks. Somebody has done that for you. Use it. So that's where the ESB comes in. It's a time-tested, performant, secure code which you can use and focus on your core development. Right? Then we expose, ultimately we expose all this using the API management layer, which gives you obviously the collaboration. You have forums, you have documentations available, you have people who can subscribe, metering, throttling, and so forth. Right? And finally, this is your customer touch points. This is how your customers would interact with your APIs. Right? Now there's a one common piece which is required by all of them, and which is your identity management piece. Right? So your application requires identity and authorization services. Your API manager might want to validate its OAuth tokens, or even your ESB might want to do some entitlement checks. Right? So you expose that as a shared service. Right? So let's look at in a bit more detail on the identity and access management needs. So this is the good old world, where you had a single user trying to access your portal from within your intranet using probably your HTTP form post or HTTP basic authentication, right? Unfortunately, that's no longer the case. Now every user has got different identities on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Google, and along with these identities, they have different profiles. They all have different avatars where you have, you know, a different profile image, a different profile calling name, and so forth. Right? And this user is now no longer accessing your system from within the intranet. He is globally located. He is no longer accessing from the machine that the company provides you. He's accessing it over mobile, over the smart TVs. Right? And that adds, he is no longer accessing it over HTTP form-based authentication. Right? There are different protocols. It's OpenID, OpenID Connect, OAuth, whatever Facebook or Google or Twitter might support. Right? And to add to it, you might not even be a user. There might be APIs accessing your system. Right? So this has changed the entire face of authentication and authorization needs. So in this, how do you manage? How do you provide roles? How do you provide different policies, or how do you administer them? Right? Solution, look at identity as a shared asset, right? Rather than every application or every layer trying to build its own solution, take it out, use it as a service. Right? So how did we do it? Our project needs single sign-on and sign-out capability that was helped using SAML from Identity Server, federated auth identity wherein you can sign in through Google, Facebook, or any other social media possibilities that was catered to using, again, federated connectors from Identity Server. You have API access based on role. Right? So you give someone access to use an API, but you want to restrict him maybe, you know, based on his role. So that can be possible using the OAuth tokens, which can be role-based. And then you have authorization layer, which is a XACML-based layer. It's no longer policy-based. So let's say you have a user or a manager whom you want to provide access that could be role-based. But now, these days, you know, it's much more complex. If that manager works out of UK, has a team of more than 20 people, has a revenue of more than XYZ, then you want to grant him permissions. So that's the authorization bit that we did using Identity Server. Right? So all this was done at a scale, which obviously required DevOps. So a quick look at the scale. We had multiple parallel feature streams, which were working on different milestones. Right? And that required various deployment environments. Right? Because you have teams working across different milestones, you obviously need to separate them out into different environments. Right? We had 4 plus developments done per day across dev, UAT, or production, or sometimes patches. Right? You want to fail fast in such a case, because if you have multiple streams working on something, you want to fail fast, you want to identify whether something has broken or not. Right? So how do you do that? Continuous integration and delivery. We have 50 plus VMs on the cloud. Right, so that requires configuration management and monitoring, not just of the hardware, not just of the application, but even for the users who are using it down to the browser layer, where you can have your console.logs from the browser being sent up to the application server. Right? So our implementation, we used Maven as a build tool, wherein each microservice is built separately using Maven. You can deploy just one microservice which has changed. You don't have to deploy the entire application stack every time. You're using Jenkins for one-click build and deploy, continuous integration. We have integrated it with Selenium, which provides us the automated JUnit coverage. We are now looking at Puppet for our configuration management based on different roles. So you have servers, which are dev, which are UAT, production. Within dev, you have API or ESB. And each could be identified as a different role and can have different configuration needs. So that's taken care using Puppet. New Relic is for application performance monitoring and browser monitoring, where every user action is being monitored and reported in real time. Right? Result, connected experience delivered. So we have completed the phase one. We are currently into phase two of the development. So we have delivered externally connected system, which caters to different connected devices using the API-centric SOA. You have delivered connected data, which is right now using data stacks plus Solr, a combination of those two. But the roadmap will have Apache Spark, which comes built in with data stacks. You have connected platforms. The entire solution is deployed on cloud using DevOps. And you have a connected UX, where you have sample applications written as AngularJS Bootstrap-based application, or you have administration screens, which are written using Bootstrap and AngularJS responsive. We even have a native mobile application for this in the roadmap. Yeah. Thank you.